Hello and welcome to the Witness History podcast from the BBC World Service. I'm Rachel Naylor and today I'm taking you back to the discovery of an extinct species of human, Homo floresiensis. It was nicknamed the Hobbit and it existed until as recently as 70,000 years ago. Peter Brown is the paleoanthropologist who identified it. Hi, Peter.
Hi, Rachel. How are you?
Yeah, good. Thank you. Thank you for speaking to me. Let's start on the 2nd of September 2003. So your colleague, Mike Morwood, is leading a dig in Liang Bua in a cave on the island of Flores in Indonesia, and he's found something special, or he thinks he has. So he gets in touch with you and he's really excited. What does he say?
He'd come back to Australia for a bit of a break between seasons, and he'd come back with a tooth, and he brought the tooth down to my laboratory to show to me and asked me what I thought about it. It had been found at around about 5 metres depth in the cave, which is fairly deep, but still may only be 14,000 years old. And I knew straight away that while it was human-like, it can't have been from a human. It was a lower first premolar tooth, and our premolar teeth have a fairly round crown and they have a single root. This tooth had an elongated crown and three roots fused into one. That's the kind of tooth root you find in early human ancestors, Australopithecines and Homo habilis from Africa, for example, which are millions of years old. And it shouldn't have been on Flores. It's only 14,000 years ago. So I'm a bit puzzled about his claims about the age of the specimen. I was pretty certain it can't have been from a modern human. But I was also aware that there had been other excavations on Flores which had found stone tools and the bones of Stegodon back as early as 800,000 years ago. So I thought it was possibly much, much earlier than Mike was claiming. So that's what set the whole thing off as far as I'm concerned. It was the most exciting bit about it, finding this first tooth.
Wow, and you got to keep it?
This is a copy of it.
Oh, I was going to say, can you have that? That would make more sense.
There'd be serious jail time if you took that out of Indonesia.
I was going to say, don't show it on camera.
Yeah.
And so what did he think he'd found?
Mike wasn't certain what he found, but as luck would have it, over the following couple of days, the team, which was still excavating at Liang Bua, around about the same place where the tooth was found, came upon a skeleton, which became known as LB1 Homo floresiensis. And because it was only 14,000 years old, Mike was saying, to me, how interesting could it really be, which is going to be a modern human skeleton? But because Mike had shown me the tooth, I was somewhat intrigued and started to take the situation a bit more seriously.
And so what did he want you to do?
Mike wanted me to come to Indonesia straight away.
What were you thinking on your way there?
I was still very sceptical. I can remember having a McDonald's hamburger, as you do, before we left at Sydney Airport and quizzing Mike again and again about the date. Now, the important thing about it was in the same layer in the cave, they also found the bones of Stegodon, these pygmy fossil elephants about the size of cows. And because Stegodon was found in the same layer, I was thinking, and we knew about the extinction of Stegodon in Southeast Asia and then on Flores, it was really unlikely they had survived until 14,000 years ago on Flores. So I was thinking Mike's dates were just simply wrong. I was hoping they were wrong. And that's basically what we're discussing and thinking and arguing about to some extent all the way to Flores.
And so then what happened when you got there?
The first thing I was shown was the lower jaw, which Thomas Setikna, the Indonesian archaeologist, had cleaned fairly well. And I think I knew within 2 seconds of looking at this lower jaw that it could not have been from a modern human. It had to have been from a human relative.
And so how did you go about finding out more? How do you measure skulls like that?
Well, I'd taken all the equipment I thought I would need through to Jakarta, including a bag of mustard seeds. We use mustard seeds for measuring volumes of things. So I sort of smuggled mustard seeds through customs in Jakarta Airport. Well, we later used those to measure the volume inside the skull to get some general idea of brain size. I had to take cleaning tools and glues and brushes and cameras, bags and bags of equipment. But there wasn't a lot of time. Normally you'd spend months preparing a specimen, but for various reasons I only had weeks. And Thomas Setikna was cleaning parts of skeleton and I started work on cleaning the skull, which was still in a block of sediment. And as I cleaned it off, the most apparent thing was it's very, very tiny. about half the size of a modern human skull, for example, and they appeared to have a brain size around about the size of an orange, really, really tiny, and various features around the skull, like the reinforcement above the orbit, this sort of brow ridge or torus above the orbit, the thickness of the bones, the shape of the skull. This clearly wasn't a modern human. There's, again, no similar, I thought, to maybe Homo erectus, which was known from the island of Java, or these very early hominids from Africa. But again, it was in the wrong place at the wrong time. How could this have been 14,000 years old?
And what were you thinking then when you discovered that this was something special and something significant?
I didn't have as much time to think as I would have liked. Fortunately, I'd been working on fossils in Asia for 20 years. I'd seen everything. I'd examined more than 5,000 skeletons around the globe and thousands of non-human primate skeletons as well. I knew what normal modern people were supposed to look like. I knew what fossils were supposed to look like at a particular point in time. I'd also been teaching the subject for 3 decades. So it just didn't make any sense at all. So the only thing which made sense was this clearly was a new species and it was different to every other species which had been found in the region to date. And what was it doing on Flores?
So how did you and the rest of the team go about finding some of these answers and confirming what you suspected?
Well, the archaeological team were doing their particular work, including with the fossil stegodon, looking at the stone tools, looking for evidence of human activity in the cave. The geochronologists were trying to zero on the dating around it, because caves are difficult places to work. And these things were too old to be directly dated using radiocarbon, for example, which runs out of go around about 50,000 years ago. So we had to use indirect dating techniques to try and estimate the age of things in the cave, very much less than ideal. So the archaeologists were doing their thing. I was working on the bones. At that time, we had legs. We had the pelvic girdle. But we didn't have any arms. We got the arms the following year, and the arms are crucial because they give you some sense of the limb proportions. Chimpanzees and modern humans have different limb proportions. They have much longer arms than we do and fairly short legs, and the shape of their pelvis is also very different to modern humans. When we found the arms in the following year, they had exactly the same skeletal proportions as Homo afarensis, this Lucy skeleton from Africa millions of years ago. That was just amazing. So then we had to develop some explanation for how this might occur. How can we have this human relative, which only looked to be about 1 meter tall, on the island of Flores as recently as 14,000 years ago, with a brain the size of a chimpanzee? When writing the paper for Nature in 2004, I came up with 2 possible explanations. I wasn't happy with either of them. The first was that Homo erectus, this large-bodied human relative known from the island of Java, had somehow got to Flores, could not have walked, had to have used watercraft too far to swim, and through time, its body size had reduced. The other possibility was that at some time in the past, an unknown small-bodied and small-brained hominid like Australopithecines had somehow got to Flores. No fossil record anywhere between Africa and Indonesia for this fossil hominid, but that was the only other possible alternative.
And so can you describe what this new species looked like?
We had complete leg bones. You can estimate your stature from the length of your leg bone. So I did that. And the first one we found happens to be the tallest one, about 1.1 to 1.2 metres tall. Complete leg bones from another individual who was much, much smaller, maybe only 0.9 of a metre tall. Bones of infants as well, which are incredibly tiny, amazing. The smallest bipeds known, of course. They didn't walk exactly like we do. We know from the shape of the pelvis, and little B1's pelvis is clearly from a female, they must have given birth to small-brained offspring. We know from the shape and dimensions of the bones, they were very muscular, like probably similar levels of muscles to chimpanzees, for example, which are much, much stronger than modern humans. The shape of the shoulder joint is really unusual, and some people have suggested this meant that they could climb much better than we can today. Like I can still climb a tree and I'm 70, but they would have had very little trouble in climbing trees, I would have thought, because they were so strong and agile. We know that they're fairly long-lived. We can tell this from the tooth wear, for example, The first one we found was around about probably 35 to 40 years of age when they died, which was fairly similar to hunter-gatherer populations 200 years ago. The wear on the teeth suggests that they were probably largely eating vegetation rather than consuming large amounts of meat.
And you touched on before that you wrote a couple of papers for the science journal Nature about your findings. How did the world react? How did the world's media react to this news?
It was a bit frustrating, frankly. I think everybody knows we gave it the name Hobbit.
Her official name is Homo floresiensis, but scientists have nicknamed her the Hobbit.
We often read about hobbits in fantasy tales, but now scientists think they've found proof that they really did exist.
And the name Hobbit was suggested to some extent by Henry G, who was our editor at Nature, in discussion with the group of working on the skeleton.
People would love there to be yetis, leprechauns, Bigfoots, Sasquatches and hobbits. This discovery suggests that there may be some truth in the old tales.
Other famous fossils like Lucy, for example, have been given names as well, but the Tolkien films had been made. The fact that they were hobbits were small-bodied and lived in caves, he thought that probably fit the situation fairly well. It didn't matter so much that the Hobbit was a story about boys and this was a female skeleton. So we went with Hobbit. It certainly added to the publicity for the specimen. I really hated it with a vengeance because of all the baggage Tolkien's hobbits carry, like these sort of 18th century English country folk who are small, live in dwellings which are somewhat under the ground. They go on adventures and do all sorts of exciting things and we are associated with people who have magic. And the world's full of people who think they have seen either Bigfoot. So for weeks and weeks and weeks, I had messages and phone calls from people who claimed to see hobbits in their backyard or knew someone who had, all because they thought the fact that it was small and found in a cave and because it had been given this hobbit, the name Hobbit was quite appropriate. I hated it, but it was too late to shut the gate.
And how did you respond to these people?
Well, you do lecture tours and you talk to them and you give them the evidence. I had a very long series of correspondence with the cryptozoology journal and trying to describe the features which are present and how it doesn't comply with any of the evidence they were claiming. You have reasoned discussions and try not to get cranky about it.
And then a couple of months later, I understand there was a bit of a disagreement about who the bones belonged to. What happened?
It was very unfortunate. The bones had been discovered by the Centre for Archaeology and the senior archaeologist there was Radian Siono. On the paleoanthropological side, there was an equivalent called Teku Yakob, who worked at the University of Gajah Mada. And he is sometimes described as the god king of Indonesian paleoanthropology. And he probably thought he should have control of any new discoveries and any important. After the team had left, Teku Yakob arrived with some people from his laboratory and without the permission, apparently, of the Centre for Archaeology, removed everything to his own laboratory and then went out of his way to invite his friends from around the planet to come and have a look at the material. And this was undescribed material which the actual research team, including himself, hadn't had a chance to have a look at yet. And unfortunately, in the course of the events, the materials were damaged. They can never be repaired. And the pelvis, which was so much like the Lucy pelvis, was damaged and destroyed because all the bones were quite fragile.
And where are the bones now?
The bones are where they should be. They're in a safe in the Centre for Archaeology in Jakarta. Yakob eventually, after there was a meteor outcry and you know, lots of people approached Yakob to return the materials. And I think there was probably some delay because they had been damaged. He didn't quite know what to do with them. People can write, get access to them, and people have. There have now been hundreds of articles written about Homo floresiensis.
And what have we learned about it as a species since its discovery?
A lot. My colleague Mike died in 2013. There's a new archaeological team involved of academics from North America and also from Indonesia. They've done more excavations of the cave and, more importantly, they've refined the work on the dating of the site. We now know that Homo floresiensis wasn't around until 14,000 years ago. They were around only until around about 70,000 years ago. That's important because the movement of modern humans down through the Indonesian archipelago into Australia happened around about 50 or maybe as early 60,000 years ago. And so the archaeologists have developed a story where modern humans moved into Flores and probably caused the extinction of both Stegodon and Homo floresiensis. I never liked that story much because there's no evidence of modern humans on Flores earlier than 11,000 years. There's just nothing there. They've also looked at more closely at the range of fauna recovered from the site. And they found other extinct species, including animals which would be a predator on things like dead Stegodon, Malibu stork, for example, and a few other animals which were preyed, and whereas it's unlikely that Komodo dragon were doing that because elephants and their relatives have very thick skin. Stegodon would have been too big, I think, for Komodo dragon to tackle. So I think they probably became extinct round about 70,000 years ago, based on the dating we now have of the site. And the only thing which could have happened was a massive volcanic eruption, which wiped out all the vegetation on Flores. And there were big volcanic eruptions in the area, like Krakatoa was the most famous example.
20 years on, how do you feel about your involvement in this discovery and how huge it was in the world of evolution?
Well, it was extremely exciting. It was the discovery of the century in a way. Like it'll never be equal, mainly because the skeleton was so complete. It was the wrong place, the wrong time. I said at the time, if they discovered an alien spaceship on Flores, I would have been less surprised. That's how remarkable it was.
Peter Brown, thank you so much for sharing your story with us.
You're welcome.
That's it for today's episode of the Witness History Podcast from the BBC World Service. If you enjoyed it, you should check out our back catalogue of more than 1,000 episodes of Witness History, wherever you get your BBC podcasts. And why not subscribe to the BBC World Service YouTube channel while you're at it? Thanks for watching. Bye.